Payphone by Lynn Canada. Feeling depressed and desperate, Nancy accepted the only job available that fit her crazy college schedule. Nancy was so close to graduation and so out of money. She knew her family could not help her and would probably just tell her to come home and just give up on her dreams. Her family never supported her decision to leave home and go away to school. Nancy's only option is to accept the overnight shift at a tiny 24-hour convenience store 30 minutes from her small-town college. When Nancy pulled into the parking lot, she made a mental note that from the outside, the building looked like the painting Nighthawks by Edward Hopper. She expected the evening clerk to give her instructions on how to use the cash register and explain her other duties. She was mildly surprised when the evening clerk was not even interested in knowing her name, much less give her any useful information. If she got bored, she was welcome to dust and clean, but it was not expected. She was welcome to all the coffee she needed to stay awake, but she had to pay for other items she might want during her shift. No employee discounts given. Then he was out the door at exactly 11:55 p.m., wishing her luck. Nancy was alone in an isolated store. She looked around, checking doors and windows. The store had three rolls of various types of convenience foods, a small cooler, checkout counter, and an office with a small desk. Nancy noted, apparently, no one was expected to dust or clean the store. The store was a mess. Nancy promised herself she would do a little cleaning, but first she would get caught up on some schoolwork. Nancy set up a workstation in the office and started working on her thesis, Education in Rural America. Nancy was so engrossed in her project, she did not really notice that there was music playing in the background. She wondered if the music was always on. She did not notice it due to the excitement of settling in, because she definitely did not turn anything on. She recognized the music as an old Beatles song she had heard on an oldie radio station her mom would play in the car when she was a kid. Using her logical mind, Nancy decided the music had been playing all the time she was working. Still, she decided to find the source of the music and change the station to something more to her liking. In a small hallway, she discovered the radio and speakers. Nancy's attempts to adjust the volume and to change station ended in failure. She was stuck with oldies but goodies. She found a cloth and started to dust the shelves as she danced to the oldies. When she got to the checkout counter, she noticed an object she had only seen in black and white movies, a payphone. Nancy wondered why she didn't notice it before. Around the phone on the walls were names and telephone numbers. She wondered about the people on the wall since the place was so isolated and lonely. Who could all these names belong to? Nancy gazed outside, seeing nothing but blackness. She was an island of light in an endless sea of darkness. Her good mood, invoked by the oldies music, left her. The sense of loneliness and isolation hit her hard. She wanted and needed someone to talk to. Nancy was settling back down with a fresh cup of coffee when the lights started to flicker on and off and the music started blaring from the speakers. The musty smell of the enclosed office shifted to women's cologne. She recognized the scent as heaven scent, her grandmother's favorite. Nancy was no longer lonely. She was scared. What will she do if the light stayed off? Then a phone rang. And it was not her cell. It was the payphone. She ran to the front of the store to grab the receiver. At that exact moment, the lights stayed on, and the music volume went back to its normal volume. Nancy started to sob into the receiver. She did not care who was on the other end. She just wanted someone to know she was scared and wanted help. The voice on the other end of the connection was soft and reassuring, and soon Nancy was able to stop crying. Nancy was so grateful to have someone to talk to. The caller introduced herself as Betty, a frequent customer. Tonight, Betty decided to call to introduce herself to the new girl at the store. Betty was delighted she just called at the right time to be of help, and both girls decided that Nancy overreacted due to the long, lonely hours at the store. Soon, both girls were laughing about the situation and chatting. Betty asked Nancy just why she was working at the store on the graveyard shift. Nancy explained her dire financial situation, and that bled into all the other things in her life that were going wrong. Nancy shared everything with Betty. It was like a flood of emotion streamed out of her. Dawn was breaking when Nancy noticed she had been talking to Betty for hours. Nancy apologized to Betty for talking so much and so long that apparently none was needed. Betty assured Nancy she could call her any time, and in fact, she could call any of the numbers written on the wall next to the phone. Betty explained they were all her friends, and they had pledged to always help each other. Nancy was now part of the friendship circle. The next night, Nancy looked forward to her shift. The store was still isolated and shabby, but she had a friend to call, and that changed everything. As soon as the evening clerk left, the payphone rang. Tonight, a male voice greeted Nancy. It belonged to Jimmy, one of the names on the wall. Jimmy was sort of a flirt, and liked the flirtatious tone of their conversation, but she needed to get to work on her thesis. Nancy explained the middle of the night was the best time for her to work. Jimmy expressed his disappointment, but understood her situation. She promised she would call him again. Before she could get herself settled, the payphone rang again. This time it was Betty, and Nancy was really happy to hear her voice. They chatted about Nancy's day. Betty seemed really interested in everything she did. After an hour, Nancy told Betty she needed to get some work done on her thesis. Finally, Nancy was able to do some work. Her thoughts were collected, and the words flowed on the paper. She felt last night's breakdown cleared her head, and she was actually going to be able to finish her thesis by the deadline. Just like the night before, Nancy gradually noticed music playing in the background when she was sure it was not playing while she was talking to her new friends. Then the light started to flicker on and off, and the music blared, and the strong smell of that awful perfume penetrated the air. Despite the perfume, Nancy took some deep breaths, assuring herself she was going to be okay. She decided to sit quietly and wait for the lights to stop flickering so she could continue to work. The problem was the music just got louder and louder, and the lights blinked faster and faster. She barely heard the payphone start to ring in front of the store. She tried to stand to get the phone, but could not move. It was like she was frozen in place. Suddenly, the music stopped. The lights came on. She was finally able to run to the phone. Tonight, she was not going to let anyone talk her into staying in the store. She was done with this job. Since the store returned to normal, she was able to pick up the phone. It was Betty, just checking on her. Nancy explained the strange events and that she was too scared to keep the job and was leaving. Betty told her she was being silly, giving up a job that allowed her to study and be paid enough to stay in school. Nancy agreed nothing really bad happened, so she decided to stay till morning. Betty started talking about her other friends, and Nancy started to relax a little and even managed to laugh at some of the escapades Betty described. Eventually, Betty talked herself out and hung up. Nancy was just about to start working on her paper when Jimmy called, wanting to talk about the night's events. Jimmy thought everything was funny and only teased her about her reaction. His reaction really upset Nancy, and she cut him off and hung up. As soon as she hung up, the phone started ringing again. This time, Nancy ignored the ringing and went back to work. The phone rang all night, but Nancy kept ignoring the calls. There were sporadic flickering lights and blaring music. Nancy just waited the episodes out and kept her mind on her work. Not that she was not creeped out. She was more desperate than creeped out. The next shift was uneventful, and Nancy was able to complete her thesis. She called Betty with the exciting news. They talked and talked, and it was just about dawn when Betty hung up and Jimmy called. He apologized for teasing her and told her how glad she was still around to talk to him. For the next 2 months, Nancy came to work and talked with Jimmy and Betty all night. Eventually, Nancy spoke to everyone listed on the wall next to the phone and counted them as new friends. Nancy felt she had joined a community of friends and wanted to meet them face to face. There was always a reason why that never happened. The semester ended, and Nancy was graduating with honors. On her last shift, she came in with plans to talk to all her friends and make plans to meet for a goodbye breakfast. The first thing she noticed was the payphone was gone and the wall was painted. Nancy was shocked and demanded the evening clerk tell her where the phone was and why the wall was painted. The clerk was surprised that Nancy was so upset since the phone had been disconnected for over 10 years. And the names on the wall were long dead kids. They were all victims of a fatal bus crash over 40 years ago. The store was the last place they were all together before they were all killed in a tragic accident. Nancy was stunned into complete silence. She just stared at the wall. The clerk asked her if she was okay to work, and she nodded okay. Needless to say, the entire shift was quiet with no unexplainable events. Nancy cried for her long-dead friends and made a silent vow to live a life that was worthy of their friendship. And Nancy did exactly what she promised. She was a kind and gentle soul to everyone she met for the rest of her life. The end.